Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In my choice to develop my loving self presentation, Jesus teaches that development of our loving self is a will-based choice, outlines the qualities needed for development, what is involved in loving self-expression, and how desire for God's love and truth is essential to receiving an education in love. Recorded on the 11th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Well, this morning our topic for this conversation is my choice to develop my loving self. Now, before I discuss with you my choice to develop my loving self, and in particular this particular discussion is going to focus on development. What qualities are we going to need for development of our loving self? And the next conversation after the Q&A will be about being your loving self. Now, the question for most people is, what's the difference? Well, the difference is development is all about your future, really, about what you're going to do over a long period of time for your future. Whereas being your loving self is all about what you're doing right now. So you could say development's all about your future motivations, your future choices, decisions, and what you're going to need to make the right choices and decisions there. Whereas being your loving self, what does that look like if you were being your loving self right now, what would you be doing? So that's the difference between those two conversations we'll be having with you. But with this one first, what I'd like to talk to you about first is the subject of choice. And there's two ways to make a choice, isn't there? One is through willpower. So what is willpower really? It's like setting your determination, isn't it? Setting your intellectual determination and just doing it no matter what. Isn't that willpower? So you have a choice. Now, one way you could choose is willpower. And as I've just mentioned, that's what that looks like. It's setting your determination, forcing yourself to go ahead and do that no matter what comes your way. Now, the only problem with that is that doesn't actually work in the long term. So you'll get some things done that way, and many of you have. In fact, a lot of the things you've got done in your life up to this day have been really done that way. So that's why you're used to using that method. The second way to make a choice, which is the appropriate way from God's perspective, is using your will. Now, what does that look like? Well, that's a much more, you could say, long-winded sort of a process in some ways, but more effective. Because what it requires you firstly doing, so number one, it requires that you allow yourself to see what impedes your will. So you have to see why you don't want to do it, in other words. So you have to look at this feeling, I don't want to. And then ask yourself, why? What emotion in me causes me to make that choice or decision? And now that you've asked why, you're looking for the emotions and false beliefs, which are fears, aren't they, that stop you from wanting to. And then you release those emotions . And how do you release the emotion? By feeling it. And then, of course, you need to develop an aspiration to feel it before you can feel it, and so forth. You have to work through why you don't want to feel it before you can actually feel it. So you can see that will requires a lot more. Developing a will requires a lot more emotional effort from you than just setting your determination and doing it. Right, and we've already said many, many times in the past that setting your determination to do something and doing it is not will. It's just willpower, and it's ineffective, and you won't get anywhere that way on God's path, on God's way. So when it comes to the choice to develop my loving self, what we're talking about is my choice, which is actually using my will to go through a process that we've already defined, but just as a reminder, my will needs to be used in this way. If I'm just setting a determination and doing it, then I'm just using willpower, and that's not what we're talking about here. So when we talk about making choices, we're talking about making choices at the soul level. And the choice at the soul level, frequently, when we've sinned, is frequently the complete opposite of what we think we want, but actually determined by emotions or emotional conditions, pain and fear, terror, that drives our decisions. And that has to be undone. So this presumes, this discussion presumes that you understand that. That everything, when we're talking about choice now, everything will be based upon the exercise of your will, not the exercise of your willpower. And that's going to require undoing the unloving choices, which we've already talked about for the previous 4 days. Remember, we've talked about understanding our unloving self and then releasing our unloving self. It's going to require that. But it's also then going to require developing aspirations to make loving will-based choices. And that's what we want to talk about in this particular subject, when my choice to develop my loving self. So everyone's fine with that? That's our focus. Okay. Now, the other thing we need to bear in mind with regard to development, so we've looked at the word choice, now we'll examine the word development. Or develop. And just see what we mean by development. By development, we really mean growth. And we're specifically referring to the growth in a positive direction. In other words, to become more loving, not less loving. Because the reality is, we could grow towards evil, couldn't we, as well, which we're referring to as degradation. But we're talking in this discussion about development in terms of growth towards positive, towards love, to being your loving self. Now, if you examine growth of the physical body, for example, some growth is automatic. In fact, the majority of physical body growth is actually automatic, isn't it? And if a child doesn't physically develop, then we're very, very concerned. And we do something generally about that medically if we can assist the development of a child to grow automatically. But here we're talking about our growth or development of our soul, which is not something that you can actually see with your eyes. And for many of you, it's not something that you can even yet feel, because that requires you identifying your real self and really starting to connect to your true self, as we talked about yesterday. But here we're speaking of growth. So here we're speaking of the growth that is required to develop the soul specifically. Now, some soul development is also automatic. In other words, the way God created the universe, if you interact with the universe in any way, there'll be some automatic growth as a result. And we're not talking about that growth here. We're not talking about the growth that the universal laws force upon you. We're talking now about the growth that you choose to engage through the exercise of your will-based decision, your will-based choice. Does everyone get that? So it's not something that, you know, the reality is God's laws, the law of attraction, the law of cause and effect, the law of compensation will cause your growth. That is a reality. But for the majority of you, that might take, if you just accept those particular laws without engaging other laws and without engaging your will, then that might take you 1,000 years, a couple of 1,000 years before you're happy. And what I'm suggesting is, why wait that long before you're happy? It doesn't make any sense, does it, really, to go, oh, well, I'm going to relax on the path, you know, this whole concept, oh, I'm going to relax on the path, oh, I'll just take it as it comes, everything will be fine. And if you have that particular attitude, then what will be fine is that you will grow automatically over time. That will be the laws will respond in a way, and you will eventually learn those laws, and you'll eventually get it, and you will eventually change, and you'll eventually become the perfect natural man. That's what God's designed into God's law. The system of the universe, the law-based system of the universe, is designed to get you back to being the perfect natural man. And that's going to happen in probably relatively inevitably in the long run. Of course, it still requires some exercise of will to become the perfect natural man, but you'll respond to law, you'll respond to the feeling of pain, and whenever you feel pain, you'll try to correct it. And after a while, you'll recognize the relationship between sin and pain, and then you'll stop sinning, and then things, happiness will naturally develop as a result of that. Now, I'm not suggesting you do that. I'm just saying that that's what automatic growth is all about, and that may take thousands of years, and it's up to you if you want to do that, but it's not what I'm recommending to you. It's also not the way to become at one with God. You will never become at one with God through automatic growth. And I need to probably say that again. You will never become at one with God through automatic growth. You will never become you'll never be in a soul union condition with your soulmate through automatic growth. Automatic growth can only ever lead you back to the perfect natural man, the state or condition that you were created in the first place. That's where it's going to lead you and no further. So the type of development we're talking about here is the type of development that's infinite, that will allow you to continually develop for the rest of your existence, to continually grow and continually change. That's the type of development that we'd like to focus your attention on. Does that make sense to everyone too? Yeah? So it's very important that we keep in that in mind, that our purpose of this discussion is making will-based choices, not will-bowed choices, to develop eternally, infinitely, my loving self. That's what we mean when we're putting forward this particular discussion. So you can see from the very outset that I'm going to need to make a number of choices. Is that not the case here? A number of choices to develop my loving self. And there's going to be choices to develop qualities. Now, remember we said, and we'll enlarge upon this more in the next group that we do, but remember we said that all of God's laws are trying to correct your attitudes and emotions inside of you. That's what they focused on. So attitudes and emotions are a part of our soul, and you could in a way call them, like there's different positive qualities, which are positive attitudes, that we're going to need for making this kind of a choice. And what are those qualities required? Well, obviously the first one is going to be the use of our will, isn't it? That gift that God's given us. If we don't choose, then obviously we're not using our will to develop, then obviously development will be automatic, as we've pointed out, but you'll never become at one with God, you'll never become at one with your soulmate, you'll never get to grow eternally, you'll be limited in your development. So if you think about it, the very first thing we need really is to understand the use of our will. Now, we spent 30 hours with you in the past group about trying to help you understand your will. And you can see why, because everything we talk about from now on is really about how you exercise this will, what decisions and choices you're going to make using this will. Yeah. So that's the very first thing. Now, what other qualities are we going to need? We've talked about, if you think about some of the things we've talked about this week, another quality that really stands out is faith. So faith is going to be a personal quality. That's something that's from within us, isn't it? These are things that are inside of us. Nobody else can do this for us. So, for example, with our will, people can inspire you to use your will, but in the end, anything you do is driven by your own will. You're far better off having an aspiration that comes from within yourself than you are being reliant on inspiration. And we'll talk more about that a bit later in this discussion. But faith is a quality that, again, is dependent upon your development, and therefore dependent upon your choices to decisions that you make to develop it. But without it, it's highly unlikely you're going to deconstruct any of this, any of the results of sin. It's highly unlikely you will deconstruct that without faith. It also is highly unlikely that you'll connect to God without faith. If you don't believe God's good and you don't believe God, you know, has God's love to share with you, then at the end of the day, you're not going to choose to receive God's love. So without faith, there's very little else you can actually do, is there, really, without that quality developed. Now, that means that we've got to spend some time developing it. And as you analysed in one of your homework sessions, you can see that many of us think we're doing something about it, and many of us have done something about it, but we're not doing very much about it. Right? We're not seeing it as one of the first things that we need to develop in our entire life. So if you think, how much time do you spend developing your garden compared to how much time do you spend developing faith? How much time do you spend, you know, doing the things that you love doing, like, you know, surfing and other things like that, compared to how much the things you like the development of faith? Like, so you look at what time you spend with music or art or any of these other things that you enjoy, and then compare that with how much time you use developing faith. And remember, right back in 2014, one of the very first things we presented to you, in fact, I think it was the very first talk on the very first day, was to see how you actually use your will, you examine how you use your time. And that will tell you how you're using your will. Right? So we can actually measure whether our will is sincere by examining how we use our time. And if how we use our time is generally for entertainment purposes, or, you know, just for work or caring for the garden or whatever other things you have in your life happening, then you can see that the will isn't very strongly developed to actually work on this issue of faith and develop some faith in God. Does that make sense? Yeah? Tara, you'd like to ask?
Can you not develop those things whilst doing the things that you love doing?
You can, but the only problem is most of the time you're not, right, if you're honest. Like, yes, you can, but let's be honest, how many of you are actually doing that while you're gardening? And how many of you are actually doing that while you're playing? And how many?
Would it mean that you're praying while you're doing those things then? That would help.
Well, faith is more than just prayer, isn't it?
Yes.
What is it?
Well,
we still struggle to answer the question, you see. So that tells me if you can't answer the question even about what faith is, then it means you've got...
Because I get confused with faith and trust still.
So this tells me that you don't know... If you don't know what faith is, how can you say that you're now developing it while you're praying? You don't even know what it is. You see, you've got to find out, you know, we've had many discussions about what it is, so have a look at those discussions again, look at what it is, and then look at what you're going to do to develop it, is what I'm suggesting.
So obviously if it's...
But Kari, can I just point out again, emotion driving you, you want to be told that you're actually doing it while you're doing other things, and what I'm saying to you is no, for the majority of you, you're going to have to spend some time at this.
Yeah, I suppose for me, because I just... It's pretty busy in my house, and I just
it's
feel
pretty
like
busy
I
in your house.
I feel like I can't.
Yeah.
Get that time.
Yeah.
Unless it's 11 o'clock at night, and then I don't sleep well.
Yeah, and why is it busy in your house?
Well.
So you're not seeing that you're doing a whole heap of things in addiction.
I'm really taking steps to address that.
Yep. I'm not picking on you, Tara.
No,
I'm just suggesting.
No, I totally
I'm
know.
Just suggesting that, like, this is where our emotions get confronted. I suggest to you that if you're not spending much time developing faith, then it means it's not very important to you. That's what I'm suggesting to you. Yeah. And then you want to argue about that because you feel you don't have enough time to develop it. But you've got enough time to develop other things. you know, you've developed all this cooking stuff that you've developed, and you've done a whole heap of other things. You've got enough time for that. And what I'm suggesting to you is that tells me that that's more important than faith is to you. And yeah. It's true, it is. At this stage, it is. And the key is to settle with that and feel that, to be honest about it. That's a part of getting out of denial, is to be honest about what's really driving me right at this moment. And still many of you are not being honest. Even after 60 hours of presentation, you're still not being honest. So you've got to learn to be honest about it. Look at how you spend your time and go, yeah, I don't have a strongly developed will to address that issue, because how I'm using my time tells me my will isn't strongly developed to deal with that issue. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
When your will is strongly developed to deal with an issue, you will place it in a very high priority. In fact, the next discussion we have about being your loving self, we'll look at the priorities in your life, and the majority of you don't even have any of the four priorities in your life as a priority in your life. So you can't expect to be your loving self without those four priorities in your life in the right order. And this is what I'm saying to you. It requires a confrontation of the truth within oneself. And that requires self-analysis, but also feel the emotion you feel. The emotion you feel, though, is it's impossible for me. It's not possible because of my family situation or whatever else, but that's not honest.
Oh, they're excuses.
They're excuses, see? And then that takes us back to the excuses we make about not developing faith. And remember, in the very first group, we talked about the excuses. Our resistance to faith was all about excuses. You know, excusing yourself, denying that it's a problem, minimizing, justifying that you have, you know, justifying really that you spend more time cooking or more time playing with cooking than you do playing with faith. You see what I'm saying?
Yep.
And you do it because playing with cooking brings you some joy. Playing with faith brings you emotional frustration.
It's actually draining me. Cooking drains me.
Yeah, that's right. So what we've got to do is allow the emotional frustration to build and develop, and to feel the emotions. Remember, these emotions are the things that are the key. So, but many of us are avoiding emotions through our actions, and avoiding our emotions by not having any faith, which was what we said in the very first group, right? So this is why faith is important. Next thing that's really important, humility. This is another thing that most of us are staying away from developing, not spending a lot of time on. To feel your emotions, what I've found personally, to feel emotion after you've been numb to emotion requires sitting quietly by yourself in periods of time that where you feel uncomfortable about doing it and uncomfortable about just like feeling yourself and allowing yourself to slowly become sensitive to the emotions that you're actually feeling. That's what it required from me, and I'm pretty sure it's going to require the same thing from you. But the majority of us are so busy doing everything else, including the things that bring us pleasure, right? And let's face it, when we've got spare time of any type, the majority of us revert to some kind of personal pleasure, do we not? Right? Rather than sitting quietly doing nothing and actually feeling what we actually feel, the majority of us, give us 10 minutes of that and we're bonkers already. You know, we're already needing to go and get some satisfaction, alternate satisfaction, some alternate distraction. We need some noises happening, right? So we turn on the radio, turn on the telly, or we watch a movie, or we need something bombarding us so that it can distract us from emotion. Humility doesn't do that. Humility sits in emotion for long periods of time until you connect to it, because you know that it's essential you connect to it. You know that it's an essential part of developing in a loving direction. It's an essential part of using my will to develop my loving self eternally. You need this time. You need to create a soul space where you have this time. Does that make sense? And without that choice, it's going to be very, very difficult for you to progress. And this is why many of you are not progressing, because you're not focusing your attention on these particular qualities, the tools. So then if you think about another tool, this tool of truth, right? But let's say it in another way. It's emotional openness and transparency. So that's truth, emotional openness and transparency. So when I talk to you about truth with you, many of you think, oh yeah, that means just telling the truth. No, I'm saying you need to learn how to tell the truth from an emotional perspective. to be emotionally open and transparent about how you actually are feeling at any point in time. That's what truth is. Right? Now, the majority of you are not doing that. Right? Even in conversations you have with myself who accepts the truth and your emotions, you still don't do it. So this indicates that truth is not a high priority in terms of development, you see? Peter, thanks.
So the humility is like basically telling us when we're out with our truth. If we've got a desire to know the truth, it's the humility that gets us through understanding when we're...
Oh, it's not just humility, Pete. I feel it's faith and like most of us have no faith in the truth. We only have faith in our addictions. You know, happiness comes from our addictions is basically what we have faith in at this stage, yeah. Right? And we don't have any faith that if I accept the truth and work through issues of truth emotionally, that I'll actually be happier later.
So is it the desire to want to know, is that what grows the humility?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, desire to want to connect to God, desire to want to know everything in the universe. Desire that those things drive you into accepting God's way, like more openly. Yeah, yeah. Very important tools, these things, and we still, you can see that we still don't really understand them completely. Even defining them is difficult for us still, let alone doing them. And this is why, the reason why is because most of us are spending little time learning about them and really experimenting with them on a daily, hourly basis in our life, just experimenting with the tools that are available to us. Yeah. So, of course, the fourth tool that we've talked about is action, isn't it? We need to take loving action. So... we need to identify that when every time we don't take action, it's because we're probably not humble to the emotion of fear. In other words, we're not allowing ourselves to feel the emotion of fear and still take action. Or we're not humble to the emotion of faith. Remember, the terror is the negative global emotion. And if we're not humble to it, you'll come and hit upon it and then you'll revert back to your facade. And faith is the positive global emotion. If you're not humble to faith and actually develop faith, then every time you look at a choice or decision, you'll go, there's no point in doing it. All I see is pain ahead of me. When that is not true, but that's how you feel, you'll say, all I see is pain ahead of me, so what's the point of doing it? If you have faith, you won't do that. So the development of the positive global emotion of faith and the development of the negative global, the release of the negative global emotion of terror requires humility, the ability just to allow yourself to feel. Now, if you take action, you will hit one or other or both of those. Now, in my previous conversation that I just had with Tara, you could see her lack of faith got hit. Does that make sense? And her lack of desire to take action got hit. That's how it is with everybody. We need to, if we're honest, those emotions will get hit. We'll see, there it is again, exposed. My own unloving emotion here, or my own lack of faith here, or my own lack of desire to deal with things emotionally here, my own lack of desire to see the truth. That's all going to get hit. And it's good for you for that to get hit. See, most of us in this place here think it's, the facade thinks it's bad for me that those things get hit, that those things, you know, we come face to face and confront those things. Our facade's saying, don't do that. You just want to be happy, pleasure, pain. That's all we're worried about. That's all the facade's worried about. Get some pleasure, avoid the pain. That's it. That's the way we're still making most of our decisions. And if we're still making most of our decisions that way, we're not choosing yet to develop my loving self. We're just going along with this pain, the false definitions of truth and love. We're going along with them. We're just saying, pain, pleasure, that's all my decisions that I need to make. And we're forgetting actually that while we continue to do that, development or growth is not possible. So do you want to grow your soul? And that gets down to will. Do you want to? Or do you just want to put it off? What do you want to do? Well, it's up to you. God has given you all these wonderful gifts, we said yesterday. God has even given you this wonderful soul that you've got immense amount of power to use and grow it. And God's given you all these other gifts that will help you grow it and help you change and help you transform. But if you don't engage any of those gifts, what's going to happen? Nothing. No growth. Just whatever is automatic to the perfect natural man, that is the only growth that will occur. And we've got that choice. We need to make that choice, that decision. Now, obviously, and that means that the action that we take needs to be in harmony with love for us to have positive growth. If we take actions that are out of harmony with love, can you see that's going to result in negative result? And it's the same with many of these things. If we keep accepting the world's definition of truth, we're going to get what the world got from their truth. Right? If we keep accepting the world's definition of what you should have faith in, then we're going to only have faith in those things and we're going to get what the world, how the world develops. But none of that's going to help us get educated in love. None of it is going to help us grow as a soul. We're just going to end up in the same place as the rest of the world ends up. Right? And where does the rest of the world end up? Well, as we said in the very first group, the rest of the world has ended up with millennia of suffering and pain. And that's where we're going to end up. Like, we have enough evidence that the world's way doesn't work, but are we willing to change that? It's interesting, isn't it? We see the evidence and we say, the world has to change. Most of us say the world has to change, it has to be better. And then when it comes to confronting the very thing that causes the world to be bad, which is all the lies of the facade and the unwillingness to feel terror and the unwillingness to feel pain, which is the main driving factor of all continuous sin, we don't address it. So the very causes never get addressed, and so the results are going to be the same. Now, it's going to require some loving action on our part for to change that. And again, we've got to look at how we use our time here. If we're not spending hardly any time doing it, then how can we expect there to be a very large change? We can't. We have to be quite dedicated, you see, to the process. Yeah. Now, obviously, it does involve two things, and that is making mistakes. And I'll put that in quotations, meaning any mistake is mistake in knowledge, right? And experimenting. We're encouraging you to do that. But what I notice is if I make a mistake, a lot of you pick on me. So that means that you're not very humble or willing to make mistakes yourself. Right? And if you don't make mistakes, you're not going to find learning easy. You're going to find learning difficult. Making mistakes and being willing to make mistakes is actually a good thing. Of course, in our childhood, we have a lot of terror about making mistakes because of the emotions and even the violence that was projected at us when we made a mistake. And we have to release some of that pain before we'll be comfortable making mistakes. Yeah. Chris, you'd like to ask?
About a year ago, I made a mistake with respect to a neighbour, a mistake in love.
Yeah.
But I only realised that in hindsight.
Yep.
Because I went to face him about something.
Yeah.
I felt some fear as a result for about half an hour, so it allowed me to release some fear.
Yeah.
And then I really realised in hindsight that I'd made a mistake in love.
Yeah.
So I'm now confused because having made a mistake in love, I have to repent for that, but I got the opportunity to release some fear.
That's why I've put mistakes in quotes. The mistake you don't want to make is a mistake in love. But you are going to make mistakes in love because this is in place. You've got to expect that that's going to happen. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You're going to make mistakes, even mistakes in love, real mistakes. You're going to make mistakes because the facade is going to need to first be deconstructed. Now, I put to you, though, that if you had accepted your facade, you probably wouldn't have made that mistake. And this is why accepting the facade is so important.
Okay.
See, when you accept your facade, you see all of your motivations, your real motivations for doing things. So you would have analysed your real motivation for seeing your neighbour and you would have found it to be driven by an addiction of some kind.
Yes, yes, it was.
Or in a fear of some kind. Yeah. And as a result, you wouldn't have taken action because okay. It would have been unloving to do so,
yes.
To feed a fear or addiction. So what I'm suggesting to you is many of our mistakes come from the fact that we're in denial of our facade rather than aware of it.
Okay. That's why it's so important to address and accept the facade first. Otherwise, you'll just continue making mistakes in love without
yes.
realizing.
Remember, it's your facade that does all the sinning. Right? Okay. So while you continue to act in your facade, driven by the pain, the facade is, right, or the avoidance of it, but by being driven by the avoidance of it, it's going to sin. It has a desire to sin.
Right, okay.
Right? So it's going to cause you to make mistakes in love. And if you accept your facade, you'll make less mistakes in love. Right? Now, many of you sort of think, well, if I accept my facade, I'm going to feel so terrible and ashamed. I'll feel really bad. Well, that's a part of accepting your facade. But you wouldn't judge that, would you? Because we've talked about judgment of that. We need to have compassion for that, how it came about. But once we've accepted our facade, you can see that making mistakes is going to be a lot more difficult because we'll see when we're driven by our addictions and we'll see when we're driven by terror. And we'll see that as an unloving decision to respond to that as an action, and then we refuse to act in harmony with that. Does that make sense?
Yes, yes.
So this is what we need to be careful doing. See, most of us are analysing things through denial or before we've accepted the facade, and then we're saying, oh, but I'm confused here. But the reality is we're only confused because we've yet to accept our facade. Once we accept the facade, we now have the ability to see what my unloving motivations actually are. You follow?
Yes. So in other words, although I had an opportunity to face my fear of talking to my neighbour, I would not have gone to see him because I would have been enacting an addiction.
Correct.
So I would have had to have dealt with my fear some other way.
Correct.
Okay.
And dealt with your addiction.
Yes.
As well.
Okay. Fine.
Yep.
Thanks.
And if you saw your addiction, you wouldn't have acted upon it. If you saw it as an addiction and therefore as a sin, you would not have acted upon it. Yeah. So good question. Go to Phoebe.
What is a mistake in knowledge? Like,
a mistake in knowledge is just not knowing something.
Because I feel like everything's a mistake in love. Like, everything I do seems to be about love, not knowledge, if you know what I mean.
I do, but that's not actually true. For example, if I ask you your opinion about something and you tell me your actual opinion and it happens to be wrong from God's perspective, I would call that a mistake in knowledge. It doesn't mean you've acted upon it or anything like that. It just means that that's what you have as an opinion. When you act upon it, that's when you make a mistake in love. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So it's okay to have a whole lot of opinions that are all out of harmony with the truth of what the truth of the universe actually is. Many of us have that, and we will continue to have that for a long time to come. And it's okay because you come up with ideas and concepts and eventually you do an experiment, so you discard it and so forth. That's how you learn. That's okay. It's like a scientist saying, I don't know anything at the beginning, but I'm going to create this experiment to see whether this is true. And he does the experiment and he finds out it didn't work. And so he says, well, that wasn't true, so I'm going to have to throw that away, or I'm going to have to change the parameters before I do the next test and to find out what is true. That's different than actually make a mistake where you act in harmony with one of your addictions, for example.
Yeah. So when you're experimenting then, because I've sort of tried to do a few experiments since the last group and I often didn't have very good results.
Yeah.
I made mistakes in love, but I
well,
was...
Well, no, see, this is where we need to take care. What I'm saying with experimenting is experiment with love, not with what's not love. So majority of you, because you've not yet accepted your facade, you're actually experimenting with things that are not love. And as a result, they're always going to turn out to be negative. And in some ways, that should build your faith. You go, okay, every time I experiment with something that wasn't loving, it had a negative consequence, and this is a good thing. It tells me that something that's not loving will have a negative consequence. It builds my faith in the penalty of God's law, if you like. You follow? So it's not a bad thing to have that happen. But it's better if you can actually work on accepting your facade, and then you can go, okay, my facade's telling me, my addictions are telling me, I'm going to act this way to do my experiment. But hang on a sec, I'm just feeding an addiction if I do that. So therefore, it's never going to turn out good. Right? Now, I'd be better off creating something that confront. So my experiment would be confront the addiction and see what happens. Does that make sense? That'd be a better experiment than actually feeding the addiction and seeing what happens.
But I feel like I did that, like tried to confront addictions, but yeah, then I went about it. Yeah, like the addiction crept
you
in.
You went
and it
about
was
it in addiction.
Muddied.
Yeah. And okay, this is the trouble. When we don't accept our whole facade, we're not aware now. We're in a state of denial. We're not aware. And a lot of our denial is purposeful. We're not aware. And so what happens is we start taking actions and experimenting with things that are actually our addictions anyway, because we don't see that it's our addiction at that time, right?
Yeah. So all of our loving action right now would be to work on accepting the facade, like...
Yeah, for the majority of you, for 50% of you, you've got to start with denial, because the reality is that's where you're at. You're denying almost everything. So you just start with denial, working for an aspiration. That's actually loving and loving action. Mm. Taking a loving action to find where I'm in denial is a good thing, right? And for the others, it's just accepting the facade, accepting all of your addictions, looking at the anger that happens when you don't get them met, and looking at the feeling you have when you do get them met, and actually analysing what drives them, the excuses, remember, the minimisations, the justifications that drive these addictions, the messages you're telling yourself, and feeling that emotionally. That's the most loving thing you can do at this point. That's where you'd be best spending most of your time. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
Yep. But that is fitting in with all of this, is it not? It's fitting in with my will being exercised to deconstruct my facade, faith that if I deconstruct my facade, I'll eventually get deeper, humility because I'm now being honest about what I really look like rather than trying to make out that I look different, and truth, I'm focusing on this truth, I'm seeing the truth of my real condition rather than making out my real condition is completely different. I'm taking action because I'm looking at myself and I'm acting out of harmony with my addictions, not in harmony with them. Now, so that still meets the qualities needed for development, doesn't it? And these qualities are needed for development in every phase. Even once you get through all of this and you've released all your pain, you're still going to need these same qualities for developing your real self. Exactly the same ones. And this is why it's so important to start developing them right up here in your denial, because you're going to need them for the rest of your life. And I'm not talking your rest of life here, I'm talking about your rest of your life period, like infinite life. You're going to need them if you're going to develop. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So these qualities are very important, and all of them are essential, in fact, in terms of you developing these personal qualities or traits within yourself. Only you have control over them. Nobody else has control over them. You do. I can't make you do it. Nobody else can make you do it. And if they try to make you do it, they would be out of harmony with love. Only you can choose to do it for yourself. Right, so you know all these ministers that get up and rant and rave and then punish you if you do the wrong thing. Well, they're out of harmony with love there. So of course, what they're trying to accomplish is not going to work. And all these religions that say that make a whole heap of rules for you to follow, they're out of harmony with love and they're not going to work in the long run. The only way this is going to work for real change to happen, for you to have real change in terms of becoming your loving self, is that the choice is made internally by you to develop these tools and to grow the use of them. Become good at using them. It's like when you first pick up anything, right? You don't know how to use it, do you? Like, if I gave most of you like a guitar, you know, most of you probably wouldn't know how to use it. you know, bang, 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 ding, 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 no, and no tune or anything. But you practice for 10 weeks and get some education, now you can start to knock out a little tune. And then maybe another, you practice for a year, some education, and now you can knock out quite a few tunes and even perhaps sing along with them because they're all in tune and so forth. So, you know, this is what it's like with using these qualities. You're going to have to actually begin using them to develop them. If you don't, then you won't develop them. But let's move on, shall we? So that's the qualities we need. You can see how essential these basic principles are, right? And we're going to keep highlighting those particular qualities to you. But we want to also focus your attention on one other thing that you're going to need, and that's personal expression. So this is a lot about being your true personality and nature, being your true self, and what it means to express yourself or share yourself with others. At this stage, for many of you, you're making it very hard to get to know you because you're having to make people to guess rather than you just be what you truly are. So you're hiding behind the curtain of the facade and people have to guess your real nature behind that. And what I'm suggesting here is we've got to learn that if we truly love others and ourselves, we would learn to express our true personality and nature. So that means trying to feel about what it is, what you really feel in that place, isn't it? And expressing it, rather than hiding it. Now, for most of you, you freely express your facade. Right? So what you do is, remember I said it's like there's a curtain here and there's a projection, you can think of it like a video projector, of your image on the front of the curtain, and that's what everybody else sees, and you're behind there doing different things. Right? And they can't see you doing those things because they're so focused on just seeing your facade. They can't see you doing those things, but when they catch you in unguarded moments, then they see you. Isn't that right? And a lot of those unguarded moments, unfortunately, are times when you've blown your top or, you know, and then you get to see what they really feel, right? And a lot of times that's the only time we get to see what a person really feels or what is really going on inside of them, rather than seeing it all the time, seeing what's really happening all the time. Kerry, you'd like to ask?
Is this what you meant by a few times you've, particularly before Paige and I went to Kenya, you said to us, just relax and be yourself?
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, most of us are not relaxed because of the terror. We're not relaxed about being ourselves. Remember, this terror is all about being ourselves. We don't want to be ourselves. The facade is all about trying to deny who we are because we were taught at a very young age that who we are was not acceptable. So we go around with the world thinking, who I am is not acceptable, so I'll just become what these people with me want me to be in the moment. And that's why we said, remember when we talked about the creation of the facade, we said that there's 7 or 8 basic facades that we have. Why do we have so many? It's because there's different groups of people who have different requirements of us, and we're so afraid of being ourselves with every group of people that we finish it up creating 7 or 8 different fragments of ourselves, and we are the one fragment with one group and the one fragment with the other. So what we do is we create, here's us, our real self. We're not happy with our real self. So what we do is we create an image of our real self that is projected depending upon our environment, whatever our environment is. So if our environment is with my partner, that's the person I am. If my environment is with my friends, that's the person I am. If my environment is with my children, that's the person I am. If my environment is at work, that's the person I am. And so forth, right? We do that for the same with our parents. And in public. And so forth, right? So there's all my facades, all being presented out to the world, right? Now, what am I expressing here? I'm not expressing me. I'm expressing what each one of those persons want, I feel, and it's my definition of what I feel each one of those persons want me to be. So I believe they want me to be something, and then I express myself to that. Now that's a lot of work. Is it no wonder you're exhausted when you're different times with different things at work, come home from work exhausted and so forth? Of course you're going to come home exhausted in almost every situation, because, and the only time you're not exhausted generally is when you're by yourself. And many of you have now gone to such an extent with that that you've now created a life that you are by yourself, so that you don't have to put up with the exhaustion of all the other facades that you have when you're with everybody else. Right? Now, if I could just continue this a bit, you can see that here I am, that's the I, well, it's not even the I, is it? It's half an I, isn't it? We learnt yesterday, it's half the I. And here I am, I'm busy, so my whole time is spent doing this, creating and maintaining these with different people. That's my time. Now, you think about how much thinking time and effort and emotional effort that requires. It's quite a lot, isn't it? And can you see that if I was just my half of I with everybody, then all it would look like is like this. Here's me, half of I, and here's me that everybody else sees, and it happens to be exactly the same thing. Now, I don't know about you, but I reckon that's going to be a lot less confusing for you. Can you see that? And this is why many of you are totally confused with different people, don't know what to do, because you're too busy doing this rather than just being this, just letting go and just being this. Just being yourself as you are. Right? Just be that all the time. And warts and all. And if it happens to be some facades exposed, then trust that God will expose them in that process, and you'll have to learn. And if you have a will developed to learn, you will learn. But if you have a will developed to avoid, you won't. It's quite simple. But for the majority of us, we're doing this. And while we're doing this, with so much time, so much energy, so much effort, so much of our life is involved doing it, that we've got no time left to be who we really are. No time left. So it's so important for you to learn to be yourself. Now, why do we do this? Well, firstly, because we deny ourselves. It's denial of self. So it's this problem up here, right? Denying myself, denying who I am, and therefore I'm presenting a facade of myself to other people because I deny who I am. Right, so that's one of my problems. Another problem is that I, because of pain and fear, so fear, we do it because of fear, and the pain that we have that might be exposed if we just be ourselves. Right, so we have multiple reasons for doing this, but all of the reasons are not valid, but we tell ourselves they're valid. Right, we keep doing that to the world. Now, what I'm suggesting is, you've got to give that up in order to have a personal, be yourself, to be the personal expression of yourself. You've got to give that up. Majority of you are fighting this process of giving that up. You don't want to give it up. But it's creating a nightmare for your life. It's your time and energy is spent doing a whole heap of things that in the end God's trying to destroy anyway. So it's really quite pointless what we're doing. We're wasting huge amounts of time in that place. Huge amounts of time. If we're just this, it's simple for me, because I don't have to try to be something with Neil over here and then something different with Justin. I don't have to be something different with the whole group than I am individually. I just be myself the whole time. So isn't that simple? Much more simple than doing this, isn't it? I've got to go, now what does Justin want from me? Oh, yes, he wants me to make him feel good and make him feel powerful as a guy, and he wants to feel superior to me, so I'll make sure that, and I know he does feel some of these things, and and so I'll make him feel superior to me while I'm interacting with him. But Neil doesn't want that from me. In fact, Neil feels inferior to me. So I've got to make him feel like he's inferior to me, so that way he'll feel like he wants to do things for me and things like that. That's the way I'm going to interact with him. Right? And then I choose a woman in the audience or something, and I'm there with her separately, and I'm feeling what I'm feeling from them and reacting a certain way. And most of these reactions are bad, like with me, at least I can feel what the guys feel or what you feel. But for the average one of you, you can't do that yet, because you can't even feel what you feel. Until you learn to feel what you feel inside of your real self and your pain and what all your false beliefs and everything, then you won't even know what you feel before then. And so you're even making assumptions about what people want from you and what they feel and what they need and so forth. Very confusing, very difficult. It's much more simple to give it all up and surrender. But you know what? We're still so terrified of being our real self, are we not? We're so terrified that we go, no, I can't do that. I can't do that. This is better. I can't do that. I can't be simple. I can't do it simply. I can't do it, just be my raw self. Ugh. Everyone, I won't have any friends then. And I find that quite ironic given the fact that really you want to give all that away, right? So let's say you give all that away and you happen to be your real self and you end up only having one friend. Well, that's all right, because you never had any friends then. They were all just interacting with your facades. They don't know you, they don't know what you feel, they only know what you project. So that's nobody being your friend, that's at least having one friend. And you at least have God as your friend in that place. Do you think you got God as your friend there? Lying all the time, being a different person for different people all the time? How connected to God can we be there? We can't be. Right, so big problems that this expression of self is all about. Very important that we learn to express ourselves appropriately. The other part we wanted to address is the fact that because we're half of self, we've got the other half, and unfortunately we're like blocked to them. Like we've got all these addictions and all these things going on that we expect other people to be, and we're completely blocked to the other half of ourselves emotionally. So that's a big problem too. To express myself, I've got to get open to the other half of myself. And to do that means I've got to work through a whole group of emotions. And in the outline, in this outline, and in the next outline in being your loving self, you'll see there's whole groups of emotions you need to work through to do that. Right? And it's important to address them. Now, if you don't address them, then of course you'll be permanently blocked to the other half of self. That means you only ever have the capacity to be half of yourself for the rest of your existence. What a waste. Besides it being a happier condition of being together with the other half, what a waste of your life being half of you. It'd be better to be the whole of you and express that. So it's a very important area, and we need to make a choice to do it. Most of us are still making an instant addiction-based choice to not do it. You know, we're being our facade before we even realize. So that means it's an addiction, a compulsion. We've got to break these compulsions and addictions in order to have a loving personal expression of ourselves. It will be easy to know. We'll be relaxed around everybody. We'll be chilled. Not always chilled in the sense of passion, because you'll be passionate too, won't you? You'll be passionate, you have desires. Be wonderful. Yeah. All right, so what else do we need in this area of personal expression? Well, we need to learn the difference. So I'll just rub that out. Yeah, I think I'll be using the other arm actually. That blue doesn't rub out as good, so I think I'll be using purple in future. Okay. The next thing I'd like to talk to you about is aspiration versus inspiration. Now, we're not saying that inspiration is a bad thing, right? Because it's a good thing. It's great when somebody comes along and inspires you to be better than you are. It's great when somebody comes along and inspires you to examine yourself more fully. It's great when somebody comes along and actually has a desire, a love for you, enough love for you to help you grow. That's a great thing. And you can't underestimate how beautiful that is. But the problem is most of you are reliant on it. And that stops you from developing aspirations. So I think Mary mentioned in one of her homework reviews the difference between you know, someone paddling a boat for you and you paddling the boat yourself. Right? Now, for many of you, you get somebody else to paddle the boat for you and then you blame them when they go the wrong way. And in fact, you like doing that because it means you don't have to take responsibility for the decision. Because they made the decision. If they did the wrong thing, you blame them. You get your addiction met either way. Can you see how you get your addiction met either way? On one hand, you get your addiction met because somebody else is doing things for you. And then when they don't do it for you, you get your addiction met by not having to blame yourself and take responsibility, but rather blame someone else for it. Right? You get your addiction met either way. Now, a person who has aspiration doesn't do that. They have a desire to paddle their own boat. That doesn't mean they're not without the desire for help when they need it, but they take responsibility for doing it for themselves. That's what they do. And a person who wants to develop their loving self needs to learn aspiration and all of the emotions involved with developing it. And needs to learn that inspiration, while it's fantastic to have it, cannot be relied upon for your own progression. It's the aspiration that needs to be developed for your own progression. All right? And if you learn that particular thing, you'll make a choice to develop your loving self. Then we come to the issues of what we desire from God. Now, we've said right from the beginning of this particular group that our motivation for doing all of these things is to become educated by God. So, of course, our desires for God are of utmost importance to us. The issue most of us face is we're not using the five tools in that area. So what we don't have faith in God, and we're not deconstructing why we don't have faith in God. We're just sort of not touching that, not looking at that. And we need to if we are going to have some desires with God. And what we desire from God is firstly, desire God's love. And secondly, desire God's truth. Because we know that firstly, God's love, if we can receive God's love, then what it does is it increases our soul's perception of love. It changes our perception. So instead of having the world's definition, so on one hand we got the world and its definition of love, and on the other hand we've got God's definition of love. Now if we've received God's love, we can compare the worlds with it. But if we don't receive God's love, there's no comparison possible. And so all we can do is judge it by our own definition. So this is what we have. We've got God's love as an option, but what we're doing is we're judging the world's love, not from God's love, but from our own definition of love. And we're comparing that with the world's. And for some of you, your condition of love is a little bit better than the world's. And that makes you feel fantastic. Right, at different times. Sometimes makes you feel superior even, which is an addiction, which is not really very loving. but this is what you feel. You say, I'm better than the world there. This is good. and then it's like, when I'm not better than the world, it's like, oh boy, you know, I'll just ignore that denial. When you've received some of God's love, what happens is you not only start analysing everything differently, you have some compassion for everybody, no matter what their condition, but also you can analyse accurately and you go, okay, I can feel something's wrong here. Because I can feel that what's happening, what emotions are going on here, there's something wrong in them. Because God's love is telling you something's wrong in them. Right? And until you get God's love, you don't feel that. Right? Amber, you'd like to ask?
In the first group, you gave a beautiful analogy of how when God's truth enters your soul, it physically solidifies, like in your soul. It's like a solidified thing that can't be removed.
Yep.
When God's love enters your soul, does that same principle apply, or is it a different kind of flavour?
Well, no, God's love is partly truth, is it not? So, of course, God's love and truth are almost, you can't have one without the other. In fact, one of the laws states of reception of God's love is that if you're out of harmony with God's love in a certain area, you will not receive God's truth on that area. Right? You just won't until you change. Right? So yeah, it's very important that both are considered, Amber. Yeah?
Okay, so yeah. They both solidify.
Yeah, they both will. Okay. And inside of yourself, then you can measure the world, what's going on in the world, and you go, oh, something's wrong here. I can feel something's wrong. Something's off. I need to address that, whatever it is. But if you don't receive God's love, then what should you give? You've only got your own love to compare with it. And our own love is just as distorted as the world's love is. So there's not much choice there. The same goes with truth, isn't it? If we receive in God's truth, we've now got something to compare things with. But God's truth requires us getting rid of all of this facade. We're not going to get much of God's truth, except God's truth about our facade initially. We're not going to get much more until we've start to work through our facade and address this terror and fear that's blocking everything. So we need to have develop these desires with God to receive God's love and to receive God's truth as a real desire. Now, for the majority of us at the moment, we don't have a desire. So what do we need to do? Develop an aspiration to have one. We need to spend some time working through. Now, how do we develop an aspiration? We need to first work out all the reasons why we don't have one and feel about that first. And for many of us, we're angry with God. We're upset with God about our past. We're upset with God about religion. We're upset with God about the way God's created the world and the universe. And there's all sorts of things that we're upset with God about. A lot of it, of course, is not towards God, really, because in the first group we learnt that a lot of it was towards our mother and father, and we've just put God in their place. But we need to work our way through those particular issues so we can separate our mum and dad from God, and we can start having some more pure concepts and ideas of God based around God being good, God being powerful, God being loving, God having desires for your happiness and helping you to be happy. And once we have these kind of things developing within our soul, now it's highly likely we'll have some desires inside of us developing for God's love and for God's truth. But again, it requires a choice. Again, it requires will. Use not willpower. Again, it requires a desire to develop the process, to go through a process of development. So hopefully what you've seen from this discussion this morning, you've seen that we've got to get to this stage where instead of sort of just sitting in places of stagnation and sort of waiting for something magical to occur. And many of us are doing that, right? We're sort of waiting for some kind of magical thing to occur and all of a sudden I'm better, right? And many of us really want that even to happen still. And many of us are even quite angry that it's not happening, right? Many of us are angry about the fact that God doesn't come along and just wave the magic wand. I can't make a tingle sound. Tingle, 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 tingle. Goes in. And all this flashy light and everything, and bang, I'm my perfect self. What a wonderful concept, we think. It's not, it's a terrible concept, because it stops you from learning everything in between. And God wants you to learn everything in between, right? And he wants you to learn about what create pain, what creates sin, what created the facade. He wants you to learn how you respond to terror. He wants you to change it, but you need to first learn what you do before you change it. He wants you to learn that so that you never engage it again. He wants you to learn these things. So we need to get into this state where we desire the process rather than desiring some magical solution. There is no instantaneous change for anyone. That's the law. All change is gradual, dependent upon the exercise of our will, is dependent on how rapidly we will change. So it really depends upon our choice as to how fast and how far we will develop. God's given us all the gifts, all the tools, all the things we need. It's just up to us now as to how we're going to use them. And so it should be. All right, well, let's have a break for 10 minutes. And we will. So that means to 20 past 12, we've come back at 20 past 12, and we have a Q&A on that subject.